The first question that I want to address, and you'll hear me refer back to some of the things that you've already heard tonight. The first question that I want to address is came from a pianist who says, when playing scales that are awkward, would you suggest changing traditional fingering, like G major in the right hand, for example? So the thing that we have to ask ourselves, first of all, is why is it awkward? I think many people find that this is the case, but let's take a look and see what happens. If we begin the scale and we end here with the third finger on the E, notice that my fourth finger is very far from the F sharp. There's no way that I can play that F sharp with any kind of ease. I'll pull towards it this way. That's going to curl my third finger. It's going to get the fourth finger very straight, and the whole setup feels bad in the hand. So you heard Edna talk earlier tonight about how in and out motions could be used to avoid twisting. And you heard Mary talk about, Mary and Bob both talk about the dangers of curling. We can also use in and out motions to avoid curling, and we have to use them in a particular way in this key. So if you take your handout and place it flat on the table or the piano, look at the legend at the bottom. You see arrows that I have to describe in motions and out motions. The arrows that go this direction take us in towards the piano. The arrows that go this direction take us out towards the body. And when we use those words, in and out, we're talking about motion in this plane. I know that those of you that are steeped in the Taubman approach already understand this, but for those who are a little bit newer, I just want to clarify. It's also dangerous to think that in means black keys and out means white keys. In and out are just relationships. And when I talk about going in, I'm talking about going a little bit closer to the piano, the fretboard, than I was a moment ago. When I talk about coming out, a little bit closer to the body. The best place to see this is at the elbow, because it's an entire motion, it's a motion of the entire forearm hand finger unit. And you can see that if I'm moving my elbow forward, I'm going closer to the fall board. If I'm moving the elbow out towards the body, then I'm moving in the opposite direction. So when we play G major, there's a particular combination of in and out motions that actually works to produce a very easy result, and it's not awkward at all. And I'd like to show you how that works. You can refer to the handout if you want, and if we start the scale of G major, you can see that when I play the thumb on the white key, my long fingers are in the black key area. Now, so that we don't curl the fingers to get them out, we're going to use that out motion from the elbow, and you can see that now my second finger is in the white key area. My third finger is still close to the black key. I'm going to come out and play that third finger in the white key area. Now I have to go back into the thumb, and when I go back in, that releases again the long fingers into the black key area, and the process starts again. I'm going to come out to the two, but now because that F sharp is coming, what I'm going to do is I'm going to move forward to the third finger, and that puts me very, very close to where I have to play the fourth finger on the F sharp. So you can see that by using the in and out motions in a strategic way, I'm able to get each finger in the right place so that the next one is easy to do. So one more time, I'm coming out on two, out on three, and on one. I'm coming out on two, I'm moving forward on three, and forward on four, and then crossing to the one again. Again, anytime I play the one, it's going to put the long fingers into the black key area. I must come out if I'm going to play white key. So out on two, out on three, into the one. I'm going to come out on two, but here's the crucial moment. I've got to go into the three, forward rather to the three, and forward to the fourth finger before I play that five. Just one brief explanation about the word forward. We use the word forward to mean the most minimal in, I guess you could say. If we play forward, the fingertip is already in the right place. I'm simply shifting my weight to where the finger is already resting on the key. The fourth finger is already in the right place. I'm simply shifting my weight to it. So you can think of forward and in the same family, and that will be fine. If the main issue is that you want to feel that forward and in take you closer to the instrument, and then the out takes you closer to the body. So all of these motions are small in the end, and if they're well calibrated, you're not really going to see too much, but you'll find that each finger is in the right place for the next one to play following it. So what happens when I go a little bit faster like this. You don't see as much movement as I was doing before, but if you're watching my elbow, you can see that I do come out and I come back in for the thumb. And then when I play that third finger, I'm moving forward so that the fourth finger feels very easy to put on the black key. And coming out for the 2-3 and for the 1, a little bit out for the 2. I don't come as much out for this 2 as I do for the 1 on 8 because I'm going someplace else on the 3. I'm going forward on that 3 for the E and then forward on the 4 and then the 5 is in the right place. A couple of other things to check to make sure that the scale doesn't have awkwardness that's caused by other problems. One of the things that is going to be true for any scale that moves away from the body, ascending right hand, descending left hand, there has to be enough lateral motion for the thumb to get into its key without any problem. Very often what happens is that people can make the right rotational motion, but they don't move the arm enough to the right, and if the arm isn't moved into a position where it's out of the thumb's way, the thumb can't get to the key. So the motion, the lateral motion, starts as soon as you leave the thumb. I'm moving over a little bit to the right as I play that 2, and moving a little bit more to the right as I play the 3. You can see that that puts me in a very, very good place to play the 1. Moving a little bit to the right when I play the 2, more to the right when I play the 3, more when I play the 4, and that puts me in a good place for the thumb. So that's something else to check in case you're still feeling an awkwardness while the in and out is correct. One other thing that you might want to check is what is the thumb doing once it releases? The thumb should be shadowing the playing finger in an ascending scale like this. It never pulls under the hand. That's going to create a kind of tension in the palm that you can feel immediately. Many people were trained that way, including me, and it gives uniformly bad results. But the thumb can trail right behind the playing finger, and that brings it close to the key that it's going to play. So I know that it's hard for you to see my thumb in this position from this camera angle, but I'm letting the thumb hang behind the 2, then behind the 3, and then it's very close to the 1. You can see that there's no sudden motion getting there. It's behind the 2, behind the 3, behind the 4, and then back to the 1. You know, just to echo what Bob said about the single rotation, if in the scale the single rotation stops to function, then you won't be able to go smoothly from the plant finger before the thumb to the thumb. So I would say that's something else to check. This is irrespective of whatever in and out combination the key you're in requires. You have to have that single rotation to the thumb. And then once you play that thumb, there's going to be a single rotation to the second finger. I should say also that it's going to be helpful if you'll release the hand in a condition to continue to that second finger. Sometimes when the motions are a little bit exaggerated, the hand releases in a way that isn't designed to continue. And that's something to watch. You want to ask yourself, when that thumb plays, is the hand in a condition to play the 2? All it has to do is drop to the right to play that 2. It's fine. Notice that, again, I'm going forward here. And then the process starts again. Just also to echo one final thing that Bob said, shaping can also help make any scale feel smoother. So we have a series of shapes that start with the thumb. In an ascending scale, I'm getting a little bit higher after the thumb and continuing to get higher until the finger before the next thumb. Then I come down to that level position that you heard Mary describe. A little bit higher, still higher, still higher, and then down again. Higher, higher, down. You can see what that looks like. I'm going to play without the talking just so you get the whole picture. So you can see it looks smooth. It doesn't look like there's an awkwardness there, and it all has to do with coordinating the many, many moving parts into a smoothly functioning whole. Now, it also brought up something else, which I thought was interesting, because a piece is in G major, it doesn't mean you have to use the fingering for the G major scale. I think sometimes people feel obligated to do this because they think that they're playing in G major and they should use the traditional G major fingering. But I would say generally in pieces, you don't have scales that start on the keynote and stop on the keynote. You have fragments of scales that may start any place and may take any kind of change of direction. I would always use the fingering that feels smoothest to the hand. And when you heard Edna talking about fingering that was economical, fingering that was efficient, it's always the fingering that requires the least amount of movement. So I thought of showing you an example from the Mozart Sonata K283 because the editor is suggesting a fingering that does mirror the fingering of the G major scale, and yet there's a fingering that I think is actually easier to do. So if you again look at your handouts and start the second measure there, we'll start where the 16th notes are. The editor suggests using the 4 on the F sharp. Now there's nothing wrong with it. I mean, it will work fine, but you see that what that does is it creates a larger movement and also the need to come out on that third finger because the third finger is in the black key area at that point. So an easier fingering, simply because it requires less adjusting, would be to put the 3 on the F sharp and save the 4 here. I want you to try it at home, both possibilities, and whatever feels better to your hand, of course, is the one to use. But there is always the possibility of changing the fingering of the key that you're in simply to suit the passage that you're playing. Let's move to the next question. And someone wrote in to discuss the left hand in Chopin Nocturne, Opus 27, number 1. It's such a beautiful piece, and it isn't that fast, but I would say that the opening does present problems, and problems that reflect an issue that you heard discussed earlier, which was the issue of stretching. You know, if you move your fingers in their normal position, they move up and down freely. Once those fingers are stretched and you try to move them up and down, they don't move nearly as freely, and that's one reason that we will always avoid a stretchy situation. We have movements to get us beyond stretching, the rotation that you heard Bob talk about, and then we have fingering choices that help with stretching as well. So if you'll take a look at the handout of the Chopin Nocturne, and what I'd like to do is look at the editor's fingering first. You'll find that what happens is the 5 goes to a 3. Now that's a fairly big distance between 5 and 3, I would say, and it takes a lot of movement. Then you have the 2, followed by the 3, by the 5. So you've got big distances built into that whole fingering scheme. I think the fingering is there so that there can be some kind of physical legato, but we very often have to choose a fingering that is not legato in order to promote the sound of legato, and I'll show you how that works here. So the first thing I would say here is that we want a fingering that is calm, that's easy, that's hand-friendly, and I loved what Edna said, that if the fingering feels good to the hand doesn't forget it. When you're at home, at the piano, I'd like you to try the difference between 5 going to 2 over that opening interval and 5 going to 3. It takes so much more movement to get the 5 to go to the 3 that you can feel immediately when you do that, that the 2 is a nicer fingering combination. Now, once we play the 2 here, we've got a big distance between the 2 and the 1. Now, you heard Bob talk a moment ago about the double rotation, and that is really the magic in a situation like this, because that double rotation allows us to get over that distance without stretching or pulling at all. For those of you who are teachers, it's one of the things that I would most look for. When you have a combination 5-2-1, you can be guaranteed that in most cases that there's going to be some kind of pulling across the keys with that thumb. You can see what I'm doing there. I'm pulling my arm. No, it's not supporting the second finger, and the thumb is not going to feel strong. When it gets to its key, it's not going to be able to control the sound well. So if you don't know about the double rotation so much, we have a streaming subscription service on the Galansky Institute website. There's information there. Of course, you can always consult with a trained Taubman teacher too. But that double rotation, it takes away the stretching and allows you to cover the distance. As if the distance weren't there, we say it absorbs distance or causes the distance to disappear. So I'm going to suggest a fingering to you, a strategy that we don't often think about perhaps, but it's a good one, and in this case, it's a particularly good one, I think. And that's repeating the thumb or repeating the 5. And in this case, we're going to do both of those. So I'd like to show you how that works. Now, if you like the editorial fingering, if that feels good in your hand and you're not having any problem doing it, I would say go ahead and do what feels good. We're not here to tell you what to do. We're here to make suggestions about what might feel better when there's a problem. So what I'm going to do here with that 2, I'm going to go to the 1. I'm going to play the 2 on the C sharp, but instead of playing that 3, you can see already how much my arm has to move over. This is even with the rotation functioning. If you have a fingering that's stretchy, the rotation itself isn't going to take care of the problem, because those rotational movements would have to be so large that it would make it difficult to play the passage in any case. So what I'm going to do here, let me get back to the same place. I'm going to put the five on the G sharp, and then I'm going to repeat it by going down to the C sharp. So do you see how that works? I'm going 1, 2, 5, 5. Coming back up, I'm going to go 2, 1, and I'm going to repeat the 1. So now I have two very nice positions in the hand. I have this combination, G sharp, C sharp, G sharp, with 1, 2, 5. And I have this combination, C sharp, G sharp, C sharp, with 5, 2, 1. So I've got two easy positions in the hand. It's just that they're not being physically connected. And we'll talk in just a moment about how we can do that with relative ease. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to go 5, 5, 1, 1, 5, 5, then 1, 1. Now, anytime we repeat a finger, we automatically have a staccato. And you might think that it's strange to have a staccato in a legato situation. Chopin even tells us here to make it legato. But legato is a quality of sound. A legato is not necessarily a physical phenomenon. And so what we do when we can't connect fingers physically is we connect sounds. And what I'm going to do in order to connect those sounds musically so that you hear them as legato, the pedal is down, of course. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to match the sound of the C sharp with the sound of the G. So it requires listening. I have to listen to what I'm doing. It's not simply repeating the finger. It's listening to the sound of the C sharp and making it match the G sharp. The sound of this G sharp, making it match the C sharp. Now, for those of you who are paying particular attention, you're going to notice that I'm doing something that Bob was talking about just a moment ago. I'm shaping, physically shaping. And what happens when we shape is that we allow the repeated finger to play at a slightly different elevation. And this tends to smooth out the experience for the hand and also for the ear if we're matching sounds in the same way that I talked about. Keeps you from feeling stuck. And I would say that for those of you that know more about the Taubman approach, we have an overshape coming to the from the fifth finger to the thumb, and we have an undershape coming from the thumb back down to the final fifth finger. So we have an overshape ascending, an undershape descending. And you can see how that circularity repeats over and over. Now, because the distances are rather wide here, the shape is going to be fairly flat. And I would say that if you impose a shape that is too much up and down, what's going to happen is you won't be able to move across. It turns out that when you move too much in any one dimension, you restrict your movement in other dimensions. So I would say that what you want to do is you want to feel that you get to the right place at the right time here. You can see that I'm letting go of the thumb. Same thing is happening on the opposite side of my hand, even though you can't see it. You can see that the hand looks very calm in what it does here. So I would suggest that you try this at home. You know, you have to understand first that the staccato is not functioning in order to articulate the sound, but in order to move you across to the next place to play. And I think when I think of staccato, that's the most useful way to think of it, that the staccato, the function of the staccato is to move you to the next place to play. So when you see me do something like that, you're hearing C sharp, but the staccato has already moved me to the place where I can play the G sharp. You're hearing the G sharp with my five, just played by my five, but the staccato has moved me into a position already to play the next C sharp. I see that I may have been a little bit overly ambitious in the number of things that I thought I could discuss tonight, and I've just about used up my time. So I'll promise you what Edna did, that there will be something to follow in the next discussion. I'll talk about the Bach Convention then. And I would like to thank you again for being with us for this session, and I'll pass the baton back to Edna so she can say a few closing words. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for joining us tonight, and I hope that it was informative and helpful. you can let us know. We will post this on the website. There are many people from different time zones who registered, but for them it's the middle of the night or very early morning. So you can look at it again, and you can send it to your friends who might be interested in some solutions that work. And you can stay in touch with us at info@golanskiinstitute.org. We have posted since last time different resources for people who are interested to know more about this work. You know, we have a very large streaming service of 143 different videos. You can subscribe to our YouTube, and then the other resources that you may find interesting. An exciting new feature is that portions of the website and the YouTube clips are being translated into other languages. The one that is most prominent at the moment is Spanish. There is a website. It started as a page on Facebook and grew so much that it's now a website called Taman Approach Latin America. So that is one that we're very excited about. French and Korean is coming next. And the flyers, the brochures for tonight were already translated into those languages. And then we have people in our community who are very steeped in the work and are open to other people who want to know more information. There will be German, there will be Portuguese, there will be Turkish. We will post those links for people who don't speak much English or not at all. And also the brochure for today was also translated into Czech and Chinese, both in Taiwan and mainland China. So if you have friends who are interested, this will make it easier. And lastly, our organization, which is a not-for-profit organization, depends on donations for running the organization, for moving ahead, and for organizing presentations like tonight and the one that we gave in June, and we hope to give more. So we are grateful for any donation of any size, and there's a donate button on our website. I want to thank from the depth of my heart for many of you who responded to us and sent us checks. Thank you so much. I want to thank also Amy Vida, who's our administrative director, for doing such an excellent job for us. And I think that this is it. I'm giving you a big global hug, and I hope to see you next very soon. Goodbye.